Hello everyone, welcome to Teach First. So today we have what promises to be an extremely interesting couple of hours on the reliability of lesson observation and what that means both for schools and school leaders and also for Ofsted as well, given the importance of lesson observations to Ofsted judgments. We are very lucky to have some really great speakers. The way we're going to run this evening is Professor Rob Coe from Durham is going to give the keynote. We'll talk for about half an hour and then we'll have some questions on that talk. We'll then have a short break and then come back and we've got David Weston, Mary Myatt, David Dadao and Alison Peacock will each talk for about 5 to 10 minutes. And then we'll have hopefully have some time left for some discussion and questions from everyone here and anyone on the live stream as well. The Twitter hashtags, that we are all here because we saw it on Twitter, presumably, so I'm imagining most of you will be tweeting. The hashtag is lessonobs, is that right, David? So hashtag lessonobs, please. And we'll take some questions on that hashtag if there are people on the live stream who want to comment or ask questions as well. So I will now pass over to Rob.
Okay, thank you very much, Sam. Am I okay to stand here? We're good there? Okay, good. So, as Sam has said, I'm going to talk for about half an hour. I hope people have seen a blog that I put up on Friday, which covers some of the ideas that I'm going to talk about. There'll be a bit more detail in today's talk and one or two new things, I hope, but some of the core of what I'm going to talk about is covered there. And I've also put, since it was originally posted on Friday, I think this morning, this PowerPoint is also available on a link from that blog post. So it's, from memory, chem.org/blog, I think is the website for that. You should be able to find it there. The link to the slides is at the bottom of the post. So these are some of the questions that I'm going to, that I guess people are asking and that I'm going to try and address. Can we judge the effectiveness? Some of the discussion around this has suggested that if we use observation formatively rather than by judgment, that we avoid some of those problems. I'm going to argue that we don't actually. I think those same problems arise, and that doesn't really get us off the hook of thinking about validity. And the question also that I think we need to think about is whether what the evidence is around whether this really does improve teaching or not. And again, there is some evidence there, but we probably need more. Okay, so this is actually a slide that I used at the Research Ed conference in September. I don't know if anyone else was here then. One or two? Yes, three. and I haven't changed it because it's the same. There are two kinds of things I think we need to be able to say if we were to justify using classroom observation, and I posed the question there, which I know a few people have picked up since, that this was the new brain gym. It's the new thing that everybody's doing that is unsupported by evidence. Two kinds of evidence we would need. One is around the validity that shows that the judgments that we're making really are about the quality of teaching. And then the other is about the impact, that if we go into lessons and we feedback in some way, whether that's through a process of evaluation and accountability, or whether that's through a formative process, can we show that that leads to improvement? This is also pretty much the same slide that I put up then. So in relation to that first question about validity, these are the kinds of questions that we would need to address. So, do the ratings that you get from people sitting in lessons making judgments, do they correspond with other things? For example, learning gains, value added, if you like. What students tell you about the quality of the teaching they've received, student ratings. Other teachers' perceptions, maybe peers or leaders in schools, and possibly also what the teacher themselves thinks. Are they consistent across different occasions, different raters? That's essentially the reliability question. And I'll talk about that, although let's see that as being a part of the whole validity issue. It's not It's not enough on its own. And then, of course, there's the issue about bias or confounds that are what observers seeing, is what observers are seeing distorted by or influenced by, spuriously influenced by some of these other things, like which class you happen to be teaching. So is it easier for me to look good in a lesson if I'm teaching one class as opposed to another? And if that's true, then what you're inferring isn't really anything about me as a teacher, it's a combination of me and that class, which is a different kind of thing. Okay, this one is also from there, the research ed slide, but I've changed this slightly. First bit is the same. So this relates to the question about how you'd evaluate the impact. And really what we'd need would be studies that met those criteria. And I think there aren't any, actually. There's one study underway that I know of, being done by Bristol, funded by EEF, which probably meets those. That will give us some good results, hopefully, in 2017. So in the meantime, there are one or two studies from the US, one of which I think is okay. And maybe there are others. There might be others I don't know about. So that'd be interesting if people do know more than I do. Is it worth it is a big question, I think, because doing this properly is not cheap. And it might be that even if it leads to benefit, it's just not the best thing we could be doing. Opportunity costs might be too high. Okay, before I get into the evidence, I think just to kind of park this one, there is room for quibbling about what do we mean by good and effective teaching. If I'm saying observation can or can't identify that, am I going to try and define what it is? Well, I should try and define what it is. I think we have to define it in terms of outcomes. Good teaching is teaching that leads to good outcomes. And outcomes needs to be interpreted quite broadly. So I'm not just talking about standardized tests of reading and maths, although that's mostly what you'll find in the research, of course. You know, there's a range of educational outcomes we value. We need to find ways of capturing those, measuring them, and then we can define what we mean by effective teaching. But until we've passed that point, I don't think we can. And other people might say that you can define teaching in terms of teacher characteristics or what teachers do or kind of moral standpoints and so on. Well, we could have that discussion. I think that's wrong. Another thing that people sometimes say is that the problems here arise from quantification, that if we didn't have categories of judgment, if we didn't have a numerical scale, that we'd be okay if we just had qualitative judgment. And it seems to me that doesn't solve the problem for us, actually, because if we're still talking about good and bad, then we're making evaluative judgments. And if we're making evaluative judgments, we still need to know whether my good is the same as your good. And how would we evidence that unless we've got some methodology for doing it? So if qualitative means purely descriptive, if I just describe what happened in your lesson and feed it back to you, well, that might be, it might be that you avoid some of the problems there. You still don't avoid them entirely, but you might avoid some of them. But as soon as you're making a judgment, then I think we have to solve this problem of knowing whether the judgment really corresponds with what is genuinely good and whether two different observers would agree. Okay, so enough of that preamble. Let's get on to the evidence. So there's a couple of things that we could look for here, or there's a number of studies. If we look at reliability in particular, the Met Measures of Effective Teaching, this is the Gates Foundation project from the US. They used those four, actually they used a couple of others as well, but those are the main ones. These are observation protocols. So these are processes of doing observation that have been developed by researchers generally. They require extensive amounts of training for people to be able to use those protocols. By accredited trainers, you pretty much have to pass a test as well once you've had that training to show that you can, your coding is accurate and so on. So this is not the kind of thing that happens in this country, unless people tell me otherwise. Okay. And what they found, then they got reliabilities. Reliability is about the agreement between two raters on the same lesson. They typically use video, so that's another dimension that people might want to talk about. You know, is that a valid way to capture a lesson with video? Okay, we could talk about that. So reliability is the correlation between different ratings, ranging between about 0.24 and about 0.68. So the top end of that is approaching something that's okay, I would say. Depends what you want to use it for, of course. Bottom end of that is a bit disappointing, perhaps. And this is the real gold standard study. They spent $50 million to get this research underway. And the amount of training, typically, I would say, to be able to use one of these, to be an observer, is between 2 and 5 days training in observation. Yeah. Other studies find similar things. So that's the Met one. Okay, now this is another really interesting study by Strong et al. And what they did was to start out by picking effective teachers as defined by value added. In other words, learning gains over a period of time. So there were different experiments they did. Some of them they would just had to be effective once, but the some of them you had to have been consistently effective. So in other words, measured by learning gains, your students made better progress than others. And they picked a kind of top end of the slice and a bottom end of the slice, and they videoed those teachers. So there were effective teachers whose value-added gains were consistently good, well above average. Another group who they were consistently below, they videoed them, and they showed those videos to different groups of people. Some of those were just members of the public, not teachers. Some of them were teachers. Some of them were kind of new or inexperienced principals, i.e. head teachers. Some of them were experienced head teachers. And what they found was there was some agreement between those different groups about what they liked and what they didn't like, what they thought was a good lesson. But that agreement corresponded not at all with the learning gains. So in other words, if you've got these videos of effective and ineffective, if you just tossed a coin, you'd get half of them right, wouldn't you? And actually, they got less than half right. So tossing a coin would have been better. Now, that's just one study, you know, a reasonably well done study, I think. I don't know of any other replications quite like it. I'm not saying that's necessarily the final word on this, but it is quite interesting, and it does pose a challenge, I think. And the head teachers, the experienced head teachers, were no better than the members of the public, actually. So that's another interesting one. So what I tried to do is to model the what those correlations, the reliability. So you've got the best case 0.7, the worst case 0.24 there. And what would that mean if you took the Ofsted categories, the four categories, you took roughly the proportions that are judged to be in those categories. That's based on the proportions of schools, so except that may not be quite the same as individual lessons. And you assumed that level of reliability means that some of those judgments would be wrong. Now, of course, some judgments will always be wrong, and particularly when you have categories that are quite rarely seen. So the extremes, the outstanding and the inadequate, by their very nature, because it's a small proportion of people, quite a high proportion of those will be wrong. But that matters, actually, because if you're judged to be inadequate, nobody says, well, we've judged you inadequate, but you might not be. They say you're inadequate. That's quite an important difference. And you can see most of those judgments will be wrong. So that's a worry, I think. Sorry, when I say wrong, this is just the reliability. This is the extent to which two different raters would agree. So they might agree and still both be wrong, or they might disagree and one of them's right, but you know, if they don't agree, that matters. This is about the agreement between the observation rating and value-added scores. And again, I think it probably should say that an ideal judgment about teaching effectiveness would contain more than just value-added scores. But value-added scores are a good place to start. I mean, there are all sorts of problems with them, but you know, let's just get that right to start with and then make it even better. And so you can see the worst case there, I've actually got a negative correlation. That corresponds with that study where, as I say, it was worse than chance. So, mostly wrong. In fact, you'd be really, it's a distortion. You'd be better off having no information than this information. Okay, now how can that be? Because everybody thinks, we've all sat in lessons, we've all watched teaching, even, I don't know, there are some people here who aren't teachers, I'm sure, never been a teacher. I'm looking at Tim. Maybe some others. Are you the only non-teacher here? Oh, right, yes, of course. Absolutely. Okay, so nobody here is not a teacher. Everybody's done, okay, fine. Well, welcome anyway. Oh, Sam, yes, of course you are. Okay, but I bet you think you can sit in a lesson and judge whether it's any good or not. No, you don't, okay. Well, the rest of us do. We're pretty sure about this. And yet the evidence seems to say that we can't. Now, how can that be true? Well, I think there are a number of things, and this is where it gets quite interesting, I think. So one is that we can certainly tell you what we like when we sit in a lesson, but whether that corresponds with what's effective is a real question. And it's very hard because we won't be conscious of the way we interpret what we see. It's quite hard to be rational about it as well, I think. Then there's a debate. Some people say, if you want to observe, I don't look at the teacher, I look at the students. Some people say that. Other people argue it the other way. Don't look at the students, look at the teacher. I think you could argue it both. I'm not sure which is right, actually. Probably neither. But I don't think it's clear cut, a priori. I think we need some evidence, really. If you do look at learners, then the challenge you've got is that you're trying to spot learning, and you can't. Learning's invisible. You can't see it. So how will you know it's happening? Well, there are proxies that you can see, which are related to learning, but they are not learning per se. If you do look at the teacher, then what you'll look at is pedagogy. You'll look at the practices that they're using. And then you're depending on your knowledge of what is effective pedagogy. How do we know what's effective pedagogy? Well, everybody knows that, surely, because it's what we do. But actually, I think one of the implications of this challenging research is that we probably don't know, actually. And a lot of the consensus about what is good practice seems to me we need to challenge, because it probably isn't right. So we've got a high level of certainty, unfortunately, is misplaced. And a lot of the things we think are good may not be. We perhaps assume that if you can do it, you can spot it, and actually being a good teacher is probably not something that good teachers are very aware of in terms of describing what it is they do. And again, some really interesting research about what you can miss when you observe, which I'll show you in a minute. So the proxies, I've talked about that before. These are things that you can see. They're related to learning, but they're not actual learning. And you can have all of those and no learning at all. And you can also have some very good learning happening and none of those. So they're not logically required. I guess empirically they're weakly related. So that's a problem. This is from one of the observation protocols, the CLASS, which is the Classroom Assessment Scoring System, I think that stands for. So that's one of the American protocols that applies across all subject areas, and there are versions of it for all ages, from preschool right up to the end of schooling. So they're modified slightly, but it's broadly the same. And it has these three dimensions that they identify: emotional support, that's the kind of classroom climate stuff, classroom organization, that's about organization management, behavior, and so on, and then instructional support, which is about how the content and the pedagogical content. And this is the distributions of teachers that were observed in this study. And the reason this is interesting, I think, is because on the emotional support, most of the teachers you can see were into the good or high quality. That wasn't too much of a problem. organization, again, mostly in the OK region. But on the one that actually empirically makes the most difference to how much children learn, most teachers they observed were in the right at the bottom end of this. This is the hard bit, if you like, of teaching. And I guess it's a question, but one of the problems of asking people who, from a population who are not very good at this, to judge others on it, well, maybe that's an unreasonable thing to do. You know, if you happen to be one of these at the right-hand end of that blue, where you understand instructional support. So that's around things like questioning and giving feedback and understanding misconceptions and that kind of thing in what you're trying to teach. So the evidence suggests that a lot of teachers are not very good at this, and that may be one of the reasons why observing it is hard if we don't understand it ourselves. This is from the study. Actually, there's a number of these studies, but this is fascinating. So psychologists show a video to a group of subjects. Of course, they are undergraduates in American university, because that's what all psychology is based on. They show them this video of people playing basketball, and they ask them things like, you know, can you count how many passes there were between the white t-shirts, or you know, something like that. So they have to focus quite hard on a specific thing. And while they're watching it, a gorilla walks through the middle of the playing area. And at the end, they say, did you notice anything odd about this game? And about half of them spot the gorilla, and the other half don't. Now, you can't believe that, can you? Because, look, there it is. But those studies are reasonably well replicated. And you're all sat there thinking, well, of course I would have spotted it. You know, all those other people might not, but I would have spotted it. Well, you wouldn't. That's the thing. When your attention is focused on particular things, you can miss other things that are around it. And we all do that. It's a human characteristic. So, of course, that's a problem in a lesson where it's complicated. There's a lot going on. You can't pay attention to everything, so you're selective and you focus. I love that study. Here's a bit more about the class thing. Talking about the amount of training, the fact that experienced teachers have strong opinions, this requires them putting those opinions aside, they say. So you have to kind of unlearn what you know about teaching in order to be able to use this observation protocol. That's quite interesting, I think. And then a bit about the amount of training you have to do and the certification. You have to pass a test that shows you can code these videos with a reasonable level of accuracy. And a certain proportion of people don't pass. And then there's this study. This is a UK study where the observers, these are researchers, they had 12 days of training in observation. Okay, so that's my first issue about validity, whether the judgments we can make reflect genuine quality. And there's some issues there, I think, some concerns. This is the second question about, If we use observation as an improvement tool, what should we expect from that? So I've said I don't think you avoid the problems of validity by saying that you're not going to make judgments, you're just going to use it formatively. And the reason you don't avoid them is because if you're giving somebody advice about what to do to improve, and actually your advice is based on a false judgment about what's good and what's bad, if they follow your advice, will they improve or will they just get worse? Or will it make no difference? I mean, actually, the evidence about how hard it is to change anything that teachers do mean that we probably shouldn't be too worried about this, because even if you give them bad advice, they won't follow it. But there's an opportunity cost there, so, you know, that's a waste of time. And so the validity issue still applies. We haven't avoided it by saying, oh, I'm just doing formative evaluation, formative feedback. There's a lot of evidence about the impact of giving people feedback in a wide range of different performance areas, and it can be positive. It isn't always positive, it depends how you do it, but certainly it can be, and it can be very positive. You look at things like Hattie's review, you know, it's the kind of off the scale biggest one, feedback. There's also evidence, though, about accountability and evaluation, and again, positive effects for that. Again, it's very much can be rather than necessarily is. It depends how you do it. But I think we shouldn't, just because we don't like the idea of accountability or we don't like being judged, we shouldn't necessarily assume that the evidence is against that, because I don't think it is, actually. And of course, whatever you do, the fact that you see some benefits doesn't necessarily justify it, because there's a cost involved in doing all these things. Okay, so that's some of the evidence about feedback and about accountability and the impact. And those are the three studies at the bottom there are the ones that I know of that I think are worth mentioning about the impact of observation. And there are two studies that show positive effects. They're both done in the US. The Taylor and Tyler is the Cincinnati studies, which are, people are talking about a bit. And that's a good study, I think. They found a positive effect. I'll show you the graph of that. Is it the next one? Yeah. Okay, so this is from that study. So the first 5 years or so, these are teachers before they were evaluated, kind of floating around average. And then in the year they were evaluated, they jump up. But what's interesting there is that they continued to be, their performance, that's measured by value added, continued to be high. So although the impact is small, it's an effect size of 0.11, if you get that every year from thereafter, that could be good value. And also, they estimated the cost of doing that was $7,500 per teacher observed. Again, that looks quite high. You divide that by the number of students they're going to teach, and actually that's kind of well within pupil premium spend, for example, in a not too disadvantaged school. So it's not an unfeasible amount of money. They also mentioned, though, there's a big opportunity cost, because most of the observers in that study were taken from high-performing teachers. So they recruited some of their best teachers to be observers in this study, and that meant, of course, that they were then out of the classroom, and you might think, well, that's an issue. In fact, it is an issue. Yes, they were. They dedicated their lives to being observers. Yeah. Because they were trained to do it and, you know, trained properly. As I say, the Bristol study, which I think is really interesting, funded by EEF, is essentially modelled on that Cincinnati model. That uses a protocol called Frameworks for Teaching, Charlotte Danielson. So I think those are good studies. The Allen et al. One, although they found a positive effect, there's some odd results there. And this is published in Science, which is a good journal. But they somehow, all their control groups seem to get worse over the year they were being taught, which seems to me a bit odd. So I'm not quite sure how seriously we want to take that. I mean, the treated groups did slightly better in the year after. They didn't do better in the year they were evaluated. A year later, they did a bit better than this control group, which had gone down. Okay. So that's the Cincinnati one. Okay, so what do I think we should do then, just to close? Stop doing what we're doing, basically. It's quite simple. Untrained observers, can they make valid judgments? Can they provide feedback that helps? We can't assume that. I don't think we can take that for granted. I think if we're interested in developing protocols or ways of doing observation that might be defensible, then we need to stop doing it amateurishly, home-baked, half-baked, homemade stuff. Let's put an end to that and include Ofsted in that, under that heading. I haven't mentioned Ofsted yet, so. But you know, there are standards about how you develop valid measures of things and from research, and that's what we should use. Thirdly, and critically, whatever we do, I think there are limits to the validity. So I showed some data where the upper limit for correlations between observation measures and value-added measures was about a 0.4 correlation. Now, we might improve that a little bit with using the best approaches. It's never going to be that high, and that puts limits on what we should be using those kind of ratings for. So if you're saying to me, is it possible to get an overall sense of, you know, with multiple observations of a teacher based on sound protocols, is it possible to use that as a basis for formative feedback that makes them think about stuff and helps them improve? Well, it probably is, yes. Is it possible to use that to make high-stakes decisions about who should carry on having a job or not? Well, no, it isn't. And since I've started talking about this stuff, people keep ringing me up and saying, you know, well, someone came in, graded my lesson, it was a 3, and I'm on a capability as a result. And I just think, well, stop that. You know, that's nonsense. You might just as well decide you don't like someone and put them on a capability. It'd be about as sound. In fact, that's probably what they did, yeah. So what we do must be justifiable in terms of what the evidence supports. That's really hard, but important. And finally, we need some better research. Well, I would say that, wouldn't I? But we really do. There's a huge gap here in terms of what we know about how feedback can help to improve, how valid judgments can be made in feasible situations. So with less than 12 days training for observers, which isn't going to happen, the full time taking out all our best teachers out of the classroom, you know, we're not going to do that. So how could we do it in a way that is actually reasonable and, you know, people might think is possible? We don't know. The honest answer is we don't yet know. So we need to think harder about how we might do that. And, you know, maybe this meeting is the start of some of that thinking, that we can actually come up with something constructive and practical that moves us out of this, frankly, rather embarrassing position we're in. Okay, thank you.
Does everyone who's asking a question have to be holding the microphone? Is that with the word?
Or could we just repeat it back?
All right, okay. Short questions. So I'm going to start with the first question. If I'm a head teacher listening to you saying that, should my response be, given the lack of good research that you said at the end, should my response be to just stop doing everything in this area, or to try and do it better, given the lack of information on what better looks like?
Okay. I'd quite like to have to repeat the question just to give me a bit more time to think about that. It's a hard one. I don't know. There are many occasions when I'm utterly thankful not to be a head teacher, and that's one of them. I think it'd be really hard. I think if I had to give advice, I would say, if I was a head teacher, I think what I would hope to be doing was, first of all, using the best evidence that there is about what kinds of things to look for are most likely to be valid. So that's one thing. But the other is, and probably more important than that, because I think you could easily get that wrong and deceive yourself, the other thing is that I'd want to be evaluating what I'm doing myself. So I'd want to be collecting, if I am collecting judgments about lesson quality from observation, I'd want to be looking to see how well they match up with other evidence that I've got. And if I find that they are matching up with other evidence that's independent, so it's no good me having a strong opinion about who's a good teacher or not, going into a lesson and just making the ratings fit that preconceived opinion. How you avoid that, I'm not quite sure, but you need to have independent evidence coming in. So I would be looking at those other things that I mentioned, the learning gains against assessment, what students are telling me about what's going on, what other colleagues are telling me about what's going on, and so on, and looking for convergence there and evaluating any process that we might be doing in a school for the extent to which it's convergent in that way. But I think my advice would be either stop doing it, or if you are doing it, don't have high expectations for what it's going to give you. You know, you're doing it because you know that you have to, but you're not really hoping for much from it.
Do you want to just...
Yeah, go on. Yeah.
One of my reasons for being here is that we have a deputy head in charge of teaching and learning. She does lots of lesson observations. In fact, she does most of them in school. And I'm in charge of the data side, the value added. And at the end of last year, we actually looked at how those two compared. And the level of correlation wasn't that great. But the issue of how can we nail down the value added that an individual teacher gives when there's so many other factors, who taught them last year, who taught them the year before, and the tutor.
Right. Okay. So the statement is that it's quite hard. So you're collecting observation data, you're collecting value-added data, you're not seeing a high level of correspondence, but you're keen to try and evaluate the impact of individual teachers, and you don't know how to do it. Yeah, well, I think it's a lot harder than people have assumed, actually. So the fact that you think it's hard means you're ahead of the game. That's a good thing. You need to have good assessment data, and that's a problem. You need to have the best observation practice that you can, and you're only, even in that gold standard $50 million research study, they're still only getting moderate correlations. So that, it's not going to be fantastic, but if you've got data over a period of time on individual teachers, then I think it does start to point in a particular direction. And if it's treated with appropriate caution and with understanding, then I think it can inform judgments that you make about which parts of people's practice is good and which parts are not. And that's the point. So the data's never making the judgment for you. You're making a judgment, but it's informed by data. And that's a really hard thing to do, I think.
I do have a question.
All right.
Why hasn't there been much research done in this? She did say at the end it's not been...
Why hasn't much research been done on this? I don't know. Yeah, I really don't know.
Yeah, if we went to a London school, for example, and spoke to a head teacher and say, show us a list of all your teachers, show us the outstanding ones, the good ones, the requires improvement and the adequate ones, they would confidently give you a list. Would you argue there is no kind of trend between, let's say, the outstanding teachers, or are they simply exhibiting the same kind of patterns of behaviour that observers are looking for?
Okay, so the question is, head teachers would know who's a good teacher, who's outstanding. Are they right or not? Is that basically?
Yeah, or, I mean, I don't know. Is it just, would you shake that list up and say, actually, that the goods could be the same as the...
Right.
Or are there some similarities between whether or not actually these are good teaching? We don't know, but there are some similarities.
Okay, so part of it is similarity, that they're in that category because of certain characteristics which might be agreed on, but which aren't necessarily the same as being highly effective. So I do think it is true that there are teachers hidden away in schools who people think are not great, but actually are fantastic. In almost every school, I've seen people like this, and when you look at value-added data, they kind of come out of the woodwork. So, they're the kind of awkward types who cause trouble for head teachers, but somehow close the classroom door and do a good job. So there's a lot of them about, I think, that kind of thing. Whereas people will think that the kind of, the brown-nosed teacher is better than they are, maybe. So there's all that stuff. But there are also studies, part of that Cincinnati one, they looked at head teacher ratings, principal ratings, and found they weren't too bad, actually. But the thing is, the head teacher who's got their eye on the ball will be looking at assessment data. They will be looking at what students are saying and so on. So they'll have all that information coming in, and they'll be blending that in ways that may well constitute good judgment. So I'm not saying tear that up and just ignore it, but I think there'll be many cases where it's wrong. Yeah. 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 Okay. The question was about video and whether that's a good way to capture lessons and whether you can judge appropriately from video. I think the evidence is that it is pretty good, actually. And some of those studies, again, they looked at things like, supposing you show somebody just 15 minutes of a lesson, or you show them the whole lesson. That was one of the things they did in the Met study. And I think it's pretty clear that if you watch three separate 15 minutes from three lessons, you get a better judgment than watching 45 minutes from a whole lesson. Okay, maybe that's obvious, I don't know. But, that's easier to do with video than it would be with real life. There's also, I think, yeah, so I think, actually, despite what a lot of teachers would think about it, video is probably better than we might assume. But again, it's an empirical question, really, because using video is a lot more convenient and it's cheaper, so the benefits of not using video would have to be quite considerable to outweigh that practically, and my guess would be that video is the way to go, actually. David.
This is a question from Twitter, actually, from David Matthews. So does it make sense for Ofsted to give teachers judgments when they come in, especially when they're looking for the wrong things?
No. Sorry, did you hear that? Read the question again.
Okay, question from Twitter from Tessa Matthews. So does it make sense for Ofsted to give teachers judgments when they come in, especially when they're looking for the wrong things?
Okay, I don't need 140 characters for that. I think two will do. The answer is no. Okay, so the comment that inspectors don't make judgments about individual teachers. Yeah. Okay, and the audience thinks they do. Right.
You know, I just think that there's a circle there that needs
squared. Okay, so I'm being accused of making teachers into ants in a petri dish.
No, I just think there is that danger.
There is a danger.
As focuses of observation by outsiders, and we're not necessarily looking at what they think about what's going on in their lesson that's being observed.
Okay, so we're not thinking about the teacher as a person who is making sense of a process, who's a professional, who's reflecting and so on. Yeah, absolutely. I, if I've conveyed an opposite impression to that, then I'm sorry. I don't... No. It's important. Yeah.
Some people, you know, when they're into this observation mode, the teacher suddenly becomes a unit of observation rather than a professional, right?
And okay. We have, because it's absolutely clear that if we're going to have genuine improvement, we have to start from this notion of reflection and professional behaviour and so on. Yes. So the idea of a kind of subject in an observational experiment, that leading to anything that's really going to help anybody do anything better, I think that's likely to be, that's unlikely. It's not likely to be fruitful. Okay. Well, I mentioned self-evaluation as one of the things that I'd want to see lesson observation correspond with, because I do think that's a valid source of evidence about effectiveness, actually, or can be. And it also, the argument that self-evaluation, is likely to be part of a formative process where somebody thinks about the feedback they've had and how they might use that. But for me, that's a hypothesis. It's not confirmed by evidence. So you know, we need to be rooted in evidence. Yeah, one of.
Thinking all the way back, we get through our school doors and looking at the top, what should we do? Stop the
school. Yeah.
We get probably 24 trainee teachers through our doors who are observed and mentored by teachers who haven't done any of this, and then we're saying, yes, you're a good teacher.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Okay. So the question is about new entrants to the profession being observed as part of their induction or professional development. Okay. So on one level, that's no different from any other teacher. You know, the assumption that once you're sort of through that hurdle, you've stopped improving. Well, do we believe that? Of course we don't. I mean, actually, it's true that most teachers do stop improving after 2 or 3 years, but it certainly shouldn't be. And there's a whole cultural issue there about how we define what it is to be a good teacher and who should be improving. You know, because who should be improving isn't just people who are inadequate, it's everybody. Is that process really helping them improve? Well, I think to some extent. So if you go back to that one about the, where was that? This one. This is quite interesting because I think the things that you learn in your first years of teaching are around organization. A lot of it's around organization because you basically die if you don't get that right and you have a miserable time. So unless you can master that, you either get, you know, you leave or you kind of learn the hard way. So the behavioral stuff and the organizational stuff, and that's relatively easy to observe. And it's also relatively well understood in a sense. You know, people can tell you things to do that you can learn from. So actually that's the part of learning that we probably do get right. The problem is this bottom one, which is the one that really makes a difference to who learns. It's about, you know, if I'm teaching math, say, I need to understand why it is that people always just misunderstand how a variable works in this site, or, you know, what does a fraction mean, or that kind of thing, and what to do about it, and what questions to ask when I'm confronted with a particular kind of misunderstanding. And that's the thing that we don't learn, because why would we? Why would you? Where's the pressure on any teacher to ever get better at that? How long do you want to keep going? Another Twitter one, yeah.
Okay, so Joe Wright at Bio Joe says, how many years of data should we be using for convergence?
I don't know, actually. I think, one of the things, you know, people will know, I work in a centre that provides assessment for schools and feeds back value-added data. One of the things we generally say as a rule of thumb is don't do anything until you've had 3 years of data. Don't make any judgments, don't sack anyone or promote anyone or kind of jump to any conclusions, because you get your first year's data and you look at it and you think that's interesting, and then the next year it sort of agrees, but it quite a lot of it doesn't. But I don't know if there's a rule of thumb about that really. I guess it depends on the scale of the difference, you know, and that in a way that comes back to my thing about the you know, the interpretations that we make need to be supported by the evidence, the validity evidence around them. So it'll depend a bit about what kinds of assessments you're using and so on. The validity evidence, we ought to have that before we can answer that question, really. It's a good question, but it's a hard one. Okay, one more. Yeah, go on, Tim. Yeah.
I can predict my evaluations for this summer, even though I haven't yet given a pass so far this term. So they're reliable.
Yeah.
Are they any more valid?
Yeah.
If they are, what is the minimum age at which we can
use? Okay. That's a really interesting question. So this is about students evaluating teaching performance. Now, certainly in North America, that's almost universal in universities. It does happen here, although I'm not sure it's so universal, but yes, it does happen, and there's quite a lot of research on this actually, and it does show that when you use the right instruments and the right protocols, so that matters. If you just make up a questionnaire, it's unlikely to be valid, but if you use a validated process, actually you get some of the best data from students. And this is the kind of blind spot, I think, where almost nobody's really been thinking about this, it seems, in a school context. And there's a lot of anxiety about, well, you know, asking students to evaluate us, that can't be right, we're the teachers. But actually the research evidence for the upper end, certainly in universities, is absolutely clear that they're reliable because the numbers of students are big, consistent over time, that the threats to validity that I mentioned earlier about just being charismatic or having an easy group or grading more leniently or all those kinds of things, again, evidence shows that those aren't serious problems. Again, when the right questions are asked and the right processes are done, and that they're valid, they do correspond reasonably well with other measures. So the question was about what age can we go down with that? Well, we don't know, because the Met study did use the student surveys as one of their elements, and that was with, as I recall, kind of lower secondary age kids. And they found, again, you know, that was probably the best measure they had, actually, because there are problems with value added, there are problems with observation, there are problems with student surveys too, but it seems like, and given how easy to do it is, well, why aren't we doing this? We've got a study underway looking at this in an A-level context in schools. Teachers have been really keen to sign up to do it, volunteers. They get this feedback, what their students think. It's quite specific diagnostic feedback about which aspects of their practice is strong and which is weak and so on. And they're supported in thinking about how they might address that. So it's quite a formative process. The study is designed to find out whether it leads to benefits in their exam results, and should have some results very soon. So watch this space. Yeah, but there's definitely real opportunity there, I think, and we should be doing more of that. So if people are interested in that and want to do a study like that with some younger age kids, then do let me know, because I'd be very keen to.
Thank you very much. It was a brilliant first half. Just on that last point, actually, we at Teach First have just done a very large pupil survey, about 25,000 pupils in Teach First teachers' classrooms, and we went down to Key Stage 2. So we did include that, and we will be trying to see if it correlates with academic attainment, although that's very hard. So we hope to feed into that debate too. So after, we're going to have a quick short break for everyone here, 10 minutes, and then we'll come back, and we've got David West and David Didow, is that pronounced correctly? I got that wrong the first time. Alison Peacock and Mary Myatt, who were all sharing their responses to that great first half. Thank you.